program. My name is Lisa Howie, and I'm the founder of The Fair. We are delighted to offer you a series of online engagements that develop understanding of and appreciation for Atlantic Caribbean contemporary art by exploring institutional and alternative approaches to regional contemporary art while making connections between the past, present, and future. Today, Readytex Art Gallery takes the helm with a panel discussion entitled Magic in the Visual Conversation. And I'm pleased to introduce your moderator today, Miguel Kierveld. Miguel is an interdisciplinary artist with a focus on curating, intuitive coaching, and creative writing. While questioning race and gender with a critical perspective, he frequently pushes the boundaries to confront generalized ideas about the processes of identification and encounters, and engages in research and artistic productions that challenge colonialization and representation. He uses theory to inform his writing process and social practice to strengthen social relations within communities, while also challenging problems of power scale and local knowledge. Miguel has a background in civil engineering and has also worked on several projects related to leadership, quality management control, artistic research, and social practice. He has participated in various art projects and residencies in Brazil and Mexico, among others. As part of his enrollment in third cycle research at the Amsterdam University of the Arts in the Netherlands, he is currently curator in residence at Readytex Art Gallery in Paramaribo, Suriname. I'm delighted to welcome you, Miguel, and your panelists and speakers. And so please take the floor. Just offer too that if we have any technical difficulties, please everybody be patient with us. Thank you. Miguel, be sure to turn your microphone on and your camera on. That's at the bottom of the StreamYard commands. And also make sure your audio is on your computer.
Yes.
Here we go.
Okay. Thank you.
Need Lisa. Your audio, sweet.
Can you guys hear me? Thank you. Thank you, Lisa. Can you guys hear me? Okay. Greetings, everybody.
Maybe check your audio on your computer or on the button on StreamYard.
Audio. Can you hear me now? Testing. You hear me? Okay. Everybody, welcome. Thanks again, Lisa. I'm greeting you from Paramaribo, Suriname. Welcome to this panel hosted by Readytex Art Gallery. I am Miguel Keerveld, a curator in residence with Readytex Art Gallery. First, I want to thank the gallery for this great opportunity. I also want to thank Lisa Howie from Black Pony Art Gallery, and of course, the sponsor, Butterfield. This year's theme for Readytex participation in the event is Magic and Visual Conversation. You may think of the theme as visualizing our desire in the hope that it will manifest, such as why cavemen made drawings before their haunting activity, which is in fact a form of stylized magic. Remember that magical thinking is enforcing reality. In a few minutes, you will have the opportunity to listen to the two speakers, Safiye Robles de Medina and Alida Neslow. In the conversations at Readytex Art Gallery, we are focused on space and time. Hence, our current project, A La Condre, A Space and Time. Within this space-time, and specifically in the artworks presented at the Atlantic World Art Fair, we, the artists, dialogue with others. However, these others are not the other in an anthropological sense. We encounter each other and different manifestations of other as both human and other than human agents. Please do read the essay, Performing Magic in Visual Conversation, on the space of Readytex Art Gallery on Artsy, where I am explaining Caribbean citizenship experience as spatialization of other. That's the art of seduction and the technology for futuristic political practice. In Suriname, this performativity is known as A La Condre. As an all-inclusive space, A La Condre borrows from different belief systems. Its all-inclusiveness allows us to focus on space and time in which we entangle the material, object, and meaning. I think that this experience exists beyond the canon of art history. It is a capacity in which we experience a space where we are all an other to each other, leaving the dominant factor behind. I am especially thankful that Alida Neslow has put a lot of effort in the years to develop A La Condre in the context of how we see ourselves. Let's watch a short video showing selected artworks from Readytex Art Gallery's booth at the art fair as I've staged them on the second floor of the gallery. I am on the second floor of Readytex Art Gallery, where I have staged artwork selected to participate in the Atlantic World Art Fair 2022. Readytex participate in this international event with a theme, Magic in Visual Conversation. This presentation is the result of a long-term process of reflection at Readytex Art Gallery. We refer to our reflective process as A La Condre, which is a specific term in Suriname that we use to refer to all-inclusive space, because A La Condre consists of natural and cultural phenomena. It's a space in which we are all others, and basically we experience this space as mamyo. Mamyo in Suriname is the art of quilting, which most of the artists at Readytex use within their creating process. That's why I refer to our way of working as mama eoism, which could be seen as a feminine manifestation of what has been known as Dadaism. I believe that Mamayoism is a space allowing us to intersect the political and the spiritual. As I personally experience it, it's an ahistorical event that allows us to create art beyond the canon of art history. Let's take a look at some of the artworks that are taking part in the booth of Readytex Art Gallery at the Atlantic World Art Fair. This is a painting made by Rinaldo Klass.
This series was created by Shondell Horton. These two paintings are work of Rene Tosari. What excites me about Readytex Art Gallery participating in the Atlantic World Art Fair is knowing that it provides us a stage to demonstrate Ala Condre to the world. And Ala Condre is this all-inclusive space that entangles different belief systems.
Latoya. As shown in the video, I feel that this appearance is Mama Eowism, the entanglement of Mama and Mamyo. Mamyo in Suriname is quilting art and technology. Most of the artwork in the booth of Readytex Art Gallery demonstrate exactly that, Mamyo. There are 16 artists showcasing 30 artworks, such as paintings, installations, and ceramics. I am referring to what we do as ahistorical. This is also performing Afrofuturism. According to the US-based digital artist, author, and educator Natrice Geskens, Afrofuturism is augmented or layered space that offers us new ways to map, view, encode, or decode traditional system and symbols with dynamically changing information. As she argues, Afrofuturism fosters the artistic practice of navigating the past, the present, and the future simultaneously. Let me introduce to you the first panelist, Xavier Robles de Medina. He is a visual artist who holds a Master of Arts degree. Xavier takes on a critical approach with the confluence of 17th century and more recent events. He describes his another as the creative process he approaches as capitalist and industrialization rooted in colonization. I'm going to repeat that. Capitalist industrialization rooted in colonialization. Quite a mouthful, but Xavier, the floor is all yours.
Thank you so much, Miguel, for the introduction. And also, I want to say specifically, thank you for the care that you put into the preparation for this event and for the booth at the Atlantic World Art Fair and at Readytex and the videos. So much effort went in. Thank you also, Alida, for your collaboration. It's been really a wonderful experience preparing for this with all of you. And I think I'd like to start with screening. I'm going to show two pieces of mine, but I want to start with a video that's mainly made of found images from Star News, Facebook, and YouTube. But it's short and sweet, and I'd like to play it for you now. So please play the video.
Uboyo mego juwa mbroko usama ya 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 gasoso uboyo mego juwa mbroko usama ya 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 gasoso. Thank you.
black arrows no ye kue Yari mi go na inyu hati Awanzi zambaza me go membre yu Ini na dibi fo mi hati Black arrows no ye kue Jari mi go na inyu hati Wanzi zambaza me go membre yu Ini na dibi fo mi hati Son tri praxeri da leti Mi du ai trove wadra Atap na doti Femina na yu Femina na yu Femina di braza Son tri praxeri da leti Tu ai trovevatra Atap na doti Femina na yu Femina na yu bebosi prasa Black Rose, dimmi che praxeri un sweetie Black Rose, dati che de, make me muso, dai con paca, na giù mi sweet Black Rose, son ti praxeri da neti. Tu hai trovato a tapna doti femina na yu femina na yu bembozi braza son te braze mi da neti mi tu hai trovato Atap na doti, pemina na yu, bebozi braza.
Thank you so much for watching my film Aisranang. Next, I want to share a text with you that I've been working on since 2019. I started it and been tweaking it and editing it for a good 2 years. And it's called Preface. A sheet with the representation of the earth or part of it. Mapping something, making an overview, sketching, describing, being off the map, being lost. On 8th March 1644, French colonizers arrive in Suriname from Cayenne with the intention of settling. They begin constructing a fort to protect them against attacks from anti-colonial Caribs. The 60 Frenchmen eventually give up, but through subsequent efforts by the British and later the Dutch, Fort Zeelandia solidifies. Thus, the settlers' defense grows out of an accumulated effort from Western European colonizers, morphing with every attempt, like an exquisite corpse. The magnitude of Carib resistance might be gauged by the fact that the Dutch call for a truce in 1684 and selectively abolish slavery for Caribs. At the very moment that the Society of Suriname is established, a private company dedicated to the supply of slaves from Western Africa, Wim Hoogbergen argues that it was far easier for recently arrived Africans to run away from plantations in Suriname compared to Jamaica and Saint-Domingue, which was probably due to the density and closeness of the rainforest surrounding the plantation's edge. The result is that Suriname has the largest maroon population in the Caribbean. On a Wednesday like any other Wednesday in Amsterdam, Paramaribo-bound passengers start trickling in at Schiphol Airport. The date is the 6th of June, 1989, and my grandmother's youngest sister, Leif, is one of the passengers about to board the plane to Suriname. The name Leif sounds like the Dutch word lief, which means kind. Also on board Suriname Airlines flight 764, the colorful 11, an entire team of young aspiring pro football players. At 11:25, flight 764 departs Dutch soil. The path is familiar, an inheritance from the Zeelandish Zeereders' first escapade to the wild coast of the Guyanas in 1597. The last third of the triangle, this plane traces from above the Atlantic Ocean the very same course that blunted the slave ship's keel, slicing through centuries of genocide and Zong. According to the Transnational Decolonial Institute, decoloniality endorses interculturality, the celebration by border dwellers of being together in and beyond the border. The voyage back to the womb, to the newly independent, freshly cooped Mama's Ranang, can feel either victorious or somber, depending on your politics, your feelings around living in Europe, and the happenstance of whom you run into. Ambivalence is the true sentiment of the diaspora. As much as we hate to admit it, we love the feeling of being recognized, not as celebrities, but as part of a lineage, as extended family. Jill Kasid writes that while since the 19th century, diaspora has been used to refer specifically to the dispersion of a people, imagined as a tribe or family unit, diaspora also signifies the scattering of seed. Stuart Hall has also interrogated the term, noting its meaning is rooted in colonially constructed binaries of original and copy, and of inside and outside. It's telling that our national flower, the Fayalobi, is only a recent transplant from India. As they look across the expansive, barging ocean to the other half, the 500,000 who chose to stay after independence in 1975, the Republic of Suriname on the 7th of June, 1989, is in economic free fall. For a second, the time is 1 hour, 23 minutes, and 45 seconds. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. In 3 hours and 3 minutes, flight 764 will arrow too low through the dense fog above the giant kapok trees and collapse into the Suriname rainforest, only a few kilometers away from its destination at Johan Adolf Pengel International Airport. 11 passengers survived the crash at 4:27 a.m. The report reads, controlled flight into terrain. My parents did not know one another very long when I was conceived. It must have been around the time of my great aunt Leif's funeral. At 5 months pregnant, my mother finally decides to introduce my father to her father. They meet on the 9th of November, 1989. My grandfather Theo offers them a warm, if slightly awkward, welcome as he naively tells my pregnant mother that she's lost weight. When my parents finally muster the courage to tell him they're expecting, A cold silence floods the air-conditioned room. After gazing to the television for a while, he finally disrupts the silence by noting, "Today the Berlin Wall has fallen." Jill Kasid argues that the contemporary practice of clearing is rooted in Roman imperial law of res nullius, which states that empty things, including unoccupied lands, remain the common property of all until they were put to some generally agricultural use. For the first person to use this land became its owner. From this logic follows, cutting down native trees, clearing undergrowth, and then burning all roots are the necessary first stages in the construction of plantations and other settlements. Maroon and slave revolts in Suriname, Jamaica, and Haiti scheme specifically the destruction of transplanted trees rather than indigenous ones, instilling a kind of reversal of settlement process, literally using colonial strategies of clearing as a weapon against the colony itself. When the Quinti Maroons in Suriname attack the plantation La Bonne Amitié in 1783, they burn down all the plantation structures except slave homes. A statue of Queen Wilhelmina, crafted by Gerard van Lom, is unveiled on Orange Square in Paramaribo in 1923. In 1947, Simon Sanchez is arrested for planning a coup against the colonial Dutch government. His goal, he claimed in court, was to humiliate the colonizers by destroying the statue of Queen Wilhelmina and to replace it with the statue of anti-colonial hero Anton Lucum, who died in a German concentration camp in 1945. The statue will stand for 52 years until the night before Suriname's independence, Stuart Robles de Medina and a team of assistants descend the colonial statue from the renamed Independence Square onto the site of Fort Zeelandia. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Safiye, for this wonderful presentation. I want to remind the viewers that Safiye's and other is the capitalist industrialization rooted in colonization. Before giving you the opportunity to ask questions to Safiye, I want to introduce the second speaker, and then after that you'll have the opportunity to interact with us. So let me introduce Alida Neslo. Welcome on this panel also, Alida. Alida is art director, independent theater maker, and internationally well-known performer. She will be contextualizing a la Condre, explaining how to understand its performativity and how to work within its speciality. Her approach goes beyond visual language. It takes on a bodily knowledge. Alida, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Miguel, and put on my other glasses. I'm for defining our art with our own terminology. That's why I'm here, to elaborate a bit more about the expression of a la Condre. It's an expression in Suriname, the language we speak in Suriname, composed of all other languages spoken in our country, and that's 22 of them. It's everybody's and nobody's language at the same time. I guess this ambiguity is typical for the whole of the Caribbean area. However, a la Condre is used whenever the expression inclusivity is used in the Anglo-Saxon world. A la Condre goes deeper than inclusivity, I think. I'll try to explain, but not everything can be put into words. In Suriname, there's a strong influence of African culture, but also of Amerindian, Hindustani, Chinese, and even Japanese culture. The people who came here through indentured labor forced by Dutch colonizers, which sets us really apart in Latin America and the Caribbean, I think. In those cultures, wisdom is often not written, but preserved in song and in movement. In a way, lucky for us, because everywhere where Europeans came, they chased the gods away. That made their world, it's my opinion, less mysterious, less poetical. Poetry, like you hear in the songs and sayings, or those, as we say, of the keepers of history, embodies the feeling that there's something magical, something you can't really grasp in reality. They teach us that it's very important that you live in harmony with all the different dimensions, seen and unseen. They are part of other as well, so that through all the different cultures here, there is a deep feeling that we have to count the other in, even if we fight. Even deep in the forest, this is felt, as is shown in the work of the Dutch filmmaker Lonnie van Brummelen, Desi Tonu Awiti, Stones Have Laws. She made it in collaboration with Maroons from a village in the interior of Suriname. Can we see the first video, please?
Eu de nata bikia na sosoa talontuya teu anionti da umupuanga pali botogwe fukisi gambusi dengao andi bia bikoni na denchawi anga pali botokonya di awatai konamo nende chawi anga pali botoko ao puse anga apaksilita kiwi musu fende wa mongo ide futang.
We damn come up a strong fan of the base, so to the aluminium. Of that day, they make them bow down. We've been frozen, come out of the car, don't you? Then gun some of
you. She was a new for them back car. I didn't touch the old one, Sunny, put you on Sunny, and they who do. They were doing. Because they didn't touch the old Gonabu, then I show me some of the day. I walk up with them, boy. Matoku, then take the ego, then go do. Uda Adano, then Amamila.
When I hear me for the baka, make a foul day, I really booya. The Takia Watafasi, the Komo hei, the photo sungu.
Life had this war. I woke up then picking food. The kid in Quao Dishina hit up we are. Because I did tell what I come. As an added hutapo, we are see if you are put up wing. We'll be saying Kaba.
Then Kuri, I got a young Panesi, I got in Tasama. I got to make it in two.
Oh, Kali then two. Make it in Kong. Ino sama anje ntongo, ino sama anje mboto.
As you heard, the last man talked about people of whole different background than his, who could come with their own boat, that is, with their own culture and with their own language. He did not say, it will be too full, or they need a visa, or we're going to build a wall, or they have to learn our own language. These are ordinary people making an extraordinary statement that seems to them very natural, but in our world, this is really something special. They embrace the situation and the people that are part of it. So there you go, Alacondre is embrace. Embrace what you got in all its authenticity without particular judgment. People may have different traditions, different rules, different, but one tradition is not bigger, better, or more beautiful than the other. No ghettoization here. Caribbean people don't speak that much about this quality, but they live it every day. Through the prism of the shared experience of slavery and indentured labor, we found each other, worked together, we had to, and created nonetheless something new out of a situation that started in the worst of circumstances. What resilience is that? Alacondre stands for resilience. More than 2 years ago, I walked in at Readytex Art Gallery and I asked Monique Nushaya, the director, whether I could pose some questions to the artists linked to the gallery. Like I thought, what I saw in their work was reflected in their surprisingly similar answers. And out of those talks came the first Alacondre Manifesto, linked to a very versatile exposition called Alacondre with True Face, our true face. And our true face is, like in the rest of the Caribbean, as multifaceted as a diamond. We are creating something new, I repeat that, maybe not yet fully understood in the Western world, because the ignorance, the fear for the other is deeply planted in the tradition they call theirs. But what I saw in the work of these artists is transcendence of tradition, where inherited traditions are revised and repossessed by those who engage to them creatively and revise their meanings in order to draw out of them new significations and revisionary values. That is exactly why I consider the Caribbean the pilot of the future world, a world where hybrid thinking becomes more and more necessary to be able to carry on in a proper way. The next step, which will hopefully lead to the second Alacondre Manifesto, this time under the guidance of curator in residence Miguel Kerfeld, we will go on in a way that, what does it mean? The question is, what does it mean to work Alacondre Fasi? The method of working consciously in a reflective ambience, which in almost magical way, I hear magic, leads to profound change, not only as an artist, but also personally. It's there that Alacondre leads to something deeper than inclusivity. But you're mostly being taught one art history at a time as a standard. Schools often ignore the fact that young people nowadays carry with them not only a national, but also an international heritage, and feel a pluralistic solidarity with events far beyond their native soil. Perhaps suggesting a movement from identity to affinity. I researched that while being director of DASARTS, a multidisciplinary international research center for advanced theater and dance in Amsterdam, the Netherlands. With L'École des Sables, an art institute in Senegal led by Germain Acogny, I put together a pluralistic program, Alacondre Fasi. The video fragments I'll show you are from Alhamdulillah, a documentary made by visual artist and dancer Janice Reisma. Can I have the next two videos, please?
Je ne vais pas parler beaucoup. Nous allons faire des mouvements ensemble. Par le geste, nous allons apprendre à nous connaître. Nous allons avoir le temps d'en discuter, d'en parler. Il y a des choses qui s'expliquent, il y a des choses qui ne s'expliquent pas. Il y a des choses que vous allez sentir, peut-être maintenant, peut-être plus tard. Et on est là pour ça, et on a le temps. Et il faut prendre le temps pour tout. Le temps de rire, le temps de dormir, le temps de vivre ensemble. Et nous allons prendre le temps. Nous sommes arrivés ici, c'était le sable. Nous avons commencé à travailler dans le sable. C'est pour ça qu'on nous appelle l'école des sables. On a planté nos tentes, on a dit ici, c'est chez nous. Je crois que tous, c'était un voyage initiatique. Pour chacun de nous, Et les étudiants, ils ne savaient pas où ils allaient. Ils disaient, on ne sait pas où on va, mais on y va. Ils avaient confiance, quelquefois avec des doutes. Et venaient me trouver, me poser des questions. Mais je leur disais, vous attendez parce que je sais où je vais. Et ils avaient confiance, ils me suivaient. Pensez un mot que vous fait penser le baobab. Et après, vous allez nous le dire. Et après, nous allons le danser. Et vous mettez vos mots ensemble. Et avec votre corps, vous m'écrivez un poème. And with your body, you write a poem for me. Ils ont parlé du temps. Moi, je donne comme sous-titre et la technologie et la nature. Parce que c'était important pour nous. Pour moi, la technologie, c'est la nature. Sans la nature, la technologie n'existerait pas. Donc, nous avons travaillé l'école des sables en face d'une lagune. Et nous avons des baobabs, nous avons des collines, nous avons des forêts de baobabs. Et c'était très important pour moi, je travaillais déjà dans la nature, de leur faire rencontrer, de leur faire écouter ce qu'il y a dans cette nature et de leur faire parler à travers le mouvement.
C'est justement pour ça que je les ai amenés ici. C'est quelque chose que moi j'ai appris aussi, que... Il y a une sagesse dans le corps qu'on a oublié en Europe. On a connu. Mais bon, si tu as des siècles et des siècles où des gens te disent, où l'Église te dit que la partie de ton ventre ne peut pas bouger, alors il y a un grand centre humain qui est vraiment exclu. Alors il y a des sagesses qui sont exclues. Alors ils ont eu... Bon, je peux le dire comme ça, mes étudiants ont eu beaucoup plus de ventre, beaucoup plus de sagesse du ventre. Il y en a qui n'ont jamais écrit, qui vont écrire maintenant, parce que mais ils ont plein de nouvelles impressions et tout ça. Alors, c'est très difficile à l'exprimer maintenant, mais ça va venir dans quelques années. C'est pour ça que je dis, je le vois déjà dans le baobab qui émerge dans leurs travaux. Ils ne sont pas encore conscients de ça, mais ils sont vraiment intérieurement, ils sont changés. Leur vie, pas vraiment, pas seulement leur vie artistique, mais leur vie personnelle en tant qu'être humain est changée de deux côtés.
C'est pas ça.
Students' comments after 2 years were remarkable. During this process, they discovered ambiguity, found that things can be several things at the same time, that this actually is the way every living thing, every lived relationship functions. Quite naturally, their work began to focus around crossing borders and building relationships between people, disciplines, cultures, and realities, as if they were constantly in transit. Alacondre means constantly being in transit. But it's not the holy praise that brings about the miracles, but the journey towards it. My pointing time and again at resilience and not the victimization of descendants of formerly colonized people has to do with the fact that once you see yourself as inheritant of multiple realities and cultures, you will discover the power of transformation, the power of Alacondre Fasi. If we do that collectively, unknown forces within us, within this planet, will be released. Maybe the possibility of the beginning of a brand new history based on affinity and not identity. We haven't realized it yet, but the magical wisdom is there within us in its multifaceted splendor. It is time, people, to shine. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Alida. Almost speechless. Really, really, thank you once again, both Alida and Safiri. Where Safiri took on a critical approach, Alida gave us context for Alakondre. Both endured a capability that allows us, that allows material, object, and meaning beyond the canon of art history. Hopefully, you have had an idea of the futuristic political practice for what I refer to as Mama Iyawism, a feminist interpretation of Daraism through which we aim at deeper nuances of a movement born out of World War II. I will be inviting you all for questions or other forms of interaction with us. Once again, Alida and Safiri, thank you for the wonderful words you shared with us. Thank you, Lucetta. The magic comes indeed from within. While waiting on the questions, I want to dive deeper into the presentations. Yes, definitely goofbombs. I want to start off with Safiri. You talked about decoloniality related to intercoloniality. Would it be possible to give an example or to say a few words more on that interesting relationship?
I think it's kind of flipping the idea perhaps related to what Alida also touched on, like changing the perspective of victimization to something that is empowering and connecting people to each other rather than separating. That's how I read it, that relationship.
Thank you very much, Safiri. I love that you connected to the relation of Alida's presentation related to victimization and how you both, in fact, take on the history and through its violence, point constantly to how the agency, the capacity to respond related to the context, is the context of Alakondre, how that is within the Caribbean strength and the Caribbean essence. I haven't seen any questions, and I think you guys have been very clear, so probably that's the case. I want to give either you or Alida the opportunity to maybe share with us something that you would have liked to share, but due to the time you had, about 10 to 15 minutes, maybe you left out of your presentation. That could be very, very relevant to share with the audience.
Well, maybe I should repeat again. You can forget everything I said, but remember, Alakondre, these words, embrace, resilience, transcendence of tradition, and being in transit. It will help you a lot. And there's people who told me, you have to claim the word, you have to whatever. But you can freely adopt it, and you can see in which direction it will take you. It is a circle. It is not a triangle or a corner. And don't you ever, ever in the Caribbean, through other terminology, let yourself be pushed in that little corner or whatever. You're in a circle. What you search is the middle of the circle. That's the only way I can express it.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And it's very difficult for people outside to define this.
Thank you very much. Beautiful. Another thing you talked about in your presentation was the releasing of unknown forces when we come together. I think that was beautifully said. And amazingly, and especially how you related it to the infinity as the magical wisdom mm-hmm. that that is within us. I think that beautifully, that's a beautiful framing of how the Alakondre is actually a force from the future, a force from the past, a force from the present, and a force entangling and taking space in the Caribbean. And I think it's about time that we make that noise in the Caribbean, either through visual language, to performativity of the body, or any other form of creative strength. And I think you two guys made an excellent narration of from your own perspective of how complex Alakondre is.
But you have to do it, because I told you, and maybe people can look at the documentary Alhamdulillah from Yannicka Dreisman. Then you will see at the end of the film what comes out when they collectively go really into what they did for 3 months, little step by step, and with a lot of contrariety and so on. I mean, it is impossible to describe that. And that's why some of my European students were really confused, because intellectually you cannot place it really, you cannot name it. And in dance and music in Southern, and people from the Southern Hemisphere and from the East, the Far East, they do not make all these little things like, I'm a musician, they make the squares. No, you have to be complete. If you do the picking opera, you have to sing, you have to dance, there's no real category. It could be something that you're good in, but it's not categorized. That is really Cartesian thinking. And when they look at the way we operate, they would say maybe chaos. I don't know. But we feel good in the say it. And I think life, as Chairman said, that nature is chaos.
There is a question, Alida. In fact, there are a question. There is a question for both Alida and Safiye. I'm going to start off with Safiye and then come back to Alida. Lisa's asking, I'm wondering if Safiye can talk a little bit about his short film, the content, and how this connects to magic.
Sure. So the film for me is connected to magic from the angle, I would say, of something to do with a sublime experience of like something sublime around a time, like an incomprehensible amount of time and layering of experience, or a non-linear type of time that I can't quite wrap my head around, of events reoccurring, and observing just little bits of things in real time in my life, but not knowing really the source of what I'm observing, that as if there is an underbelly or a skeleton that I don't have access to, but I'm just trying to find all of the clues that I feel are connecting them to each other. So my observation of it is as if they manifest through magic, or and my experience of that is very, very much related to the sublime. I think that there's many different levels. I'm relating emotionally, but also trying to be kind of factual about certain events. So I'm really working with the photographic and film archives that I'm able to find, but there's so much that hasn't been recorded, and which we know we don't have access to only from being present and really observing everyday life, and I think there's a lot of magic in that as well.
That's it.
Yes, thank you. Yes, as Safiye said, like I'm going to try to summarize, and correct me if I'm wrong, Safiye. Basically, through the spell of magic, there is this capacity to transform violence into strength. Have I framed it good, or do you want to add something to it?
Yeah, no, I like that framing of it.
Okay, thank you very much. There is a question for Alida also. The question is if has Foralida, has she taken her program other islands in the Atlantic or the Caribbean? And if so, have you observed the same positive outcomes?
Yeah, the strange thing is I'm doing this for more than 25 years. And I've been from Spain to Egypt to, I don't know, a lot of places. But since I was a lot of my life far away from Suriname, I didn't have that much experience in the Caribbean as I have in the other places. But I went with the music. I do sometimes with another discipline. And I went with the music program to, I think, Barbados, was it, and Guyana. And in a way, it's amazing what comes out of people. I do it together with somebody from Peru. I have a partner with whom I work. And it's amazing. And people stay in contact with you a long time after you've gone. I did it with the Alakondri Drung, what we call the Alakondri Drung in Suriname. It's in a very special orchestra, I think, one of a kind, in which all the percussions of the countries, the original countries, like in Africa, Asia, and so on, in their Surinamese version, are put into one hole, and they play music that is completely, I think, new to a lot of people's ears. And you have to see that the people, when I say resilience, also coming back on that, the gamelan, the instrument of the Indonesians, of the Javanese especially, is also in Suriname. But we have a gamelan that is completely unique, that doesn't exist even in Indonesia. And but it was made by what the Javanese people found here, you know, first from little, you know, cans, tins, whatever. And it sounds so good that the Indonesians themselves now have adopted this as their inheritance as well. So we send something back. Suriname has, the Caribbean has a gift to give to the rest of the world, you know. As I said, we made something new. In their distress, the beatings that they got, they put it into rhythm, into dance, into music, and it is adopted by the motherland. I think that it's extraordinary. And it's not very difficult then, because it's done in such a simple way. Simple is not easy, huh? In such a simple way that you can engage other people really to make something coming out of their own heart, like painting on a cloth but working on a maroon pattern or something that always has a meaning here. A cloth in Europe has no meaning most of the time, huh? But you can it's very strange, but I met people really didn't want to lose that cloth anymore. They would keep it if they say, okay, I want to take it with me. No, I keep it forever to remind me of what I did today. So I've been through a few islands, but my knowledge is more from, but it's enough for me because people are people. I mean, and people of Spain don't know anything about us, believe me, really. And they have their standard thinking of, yeah, Latin America follows us and they speak Spanish. But even the Spanish is not like the Spanish from Spain. So sometimes they don't see what we created here in everyday life. As Xavier says, the biggest film, the biggest one is the everyday life. But there's little miracles there, and we have to have eyes for that and not only look over the ocean like, oh, this isn't that, and we have to answer to that. No! We have to listen to ourselves and look at ourselves through all the fighting, through all the decay, through everything, through the dirt. We are those diamonds that are not completely wiped, clean again, but it's there. And we have the future. We have a motherland, we have a fatherland. We are hybrid from the moment we were being born. He has the Berlin Wall in him, really, at the moment that he was conceived. Huh? There was he lives in Berlin now. I mean, To him, it's not strange, but tell people from Berlin about Suriname.
That will have to
really strange.
Yes, it's a joy to listen to Alida. Thank you very much. Alida, that was beautifully said. Wonderful. It's been an hour that we have been busy. So once again, Xavier, Alida, and all audience, thank you very much. I also want to thank once again Readytex Art Gallery, Black Pony Gallery, and of course the sponsor Butterfield. I also want to encourage you all to check out the rest of the program of the Atlantic World Art Fair, and please share it through your networks, because it's going to be an amazing time of art, Caribbean essence, all the way until May 5th. Once again, guys, thank you very much, and have a wonderful weekend.
Thank you.
Thank you too, Miguel, and for everything you brought to the gallery.
Thank you.
Thank you, Fafi. You're my son.
Thank you, Alida. Thank you, Miguel.
Yes.